afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the Long Beach Museum of Art and to this really special day and this fabulous opportunity to have a deeper look and a deeper understanding of the artwork that we have. This is a big exhibition for us. We're really, really thrilled to have this. And this has been 3 years in the making. And the story and just the narrative that goes along with this is really quite thrilling and very moving. And we're fortunate today to have the artist's daughter, Hortensia. So, and then Elizabeth Poizetta. Elizabeth is the editor. She brought the catalog together. She wrote a fabulous piece inside and this catalog. And
for sale downstairs.
For sale downstairs. And a great opportunity to get it signed, because when this is done, you're all going to be smarter, and you're all going to like, oh, I wish I would have thought of that. And coming from that also is Roberto Quezada is also from Boston College, and I can't even go on and on and on to tell you the esteemed honors and awards that this gentleman has had, and how many shows you've curated, and how many places you've been to do all these. So we're thrilled to have you here. Everyone knows Dr. Claudia von Spechta.
And that's Claudia is our.
So Claudia's going to be running this, and thank you very much, and enjoy.
Okay, so yes, I'm Claudia von Spechta, and I'd like to welcome you all to this conversation here today. And it's a great pleasure for me, because I inherited the show, and people always come up to me and say, oh, what a wonderful show. I said, I have nothing to do with it. I just put it up on the wall. And to have these people here with me to talk about Rafael Soriano. And what I'm particularly pleased with is that you're going to get, I think, three very different and very distinct perspectives on this artist. So Hortensia, obviously, is the artist's daughter. She will have a very personal, private, biographical approach to her father's work. We're going to have Elizabeth, who is a curator and scholar, who has done a tremendous amount of research into Soriano and knows just about everything there is to know about him. And Roberto is a professor of Catholic theology, which is, I think, particularly apropos of Rafael Soriano's work. So I think, you know, as we're kind of going through this conversation, we're gonna hear everything from the personal to the scholarly to the metaphysical. So we're gonna do like the whole 360 degrees on Rafael Soriano. So fasten your seatbelts. And I'd like to start with Hortensia, who was born in Havana, correct?
Matanzas.
And came to Florida with your father and your mother when you were 2 years old. And I've done a bunch of work with people whose parents have been famous artists, and I understand that can be both a blessing and a curse. And I'm curious to find out when you first realized, you probably always knew your father was an artist, but when did you realize that he was an important artist?
Well, hi everybody, and well, I'm so honored and pleased to be here at Long Beach Museum of Art. And I am the only child of Rafael Soriano and Milagro Soriano, and I must admit, I did not always get the full love and attention I required.
most children don't.
Because I had to share everything with these paintings, okay? These paintings were loved for, they were cared for, they were named very diligently as you would name a child. So these are kind of like my siblings. You know, I grew up with them and, but yeah, what was the question again?
When you realized that he was not just an artist who kind of smelled funny when he came down for dinner, but who actually contributed something really meaningful.
I would say I was probably 5 or 6 years old, and I just, you know, he would paint at night. I always wondered why, you know, he wasn't playing with me at night. And my mother said to me once, your father is doing very important work in the Florida room, so you were not to bother him. And I never bothered him, so I knew that what he was doing back there was pretty special. So So I would say I was 5 or 6 years old.
Did Rafael talk about his art at the dinner table, or how expressive was he about what he was doing in the privacy of your home?
Well, I have to say my father was a man of very few words. He didn't really talk much about his art, but what he did do is when he finished a painting, he would call both me and my mom into the room, and we would have a conversation about what we saw in the painting, what we felt about the painting, and then they would proceed to name the painting, and sometimes it got a little heated, you know, I must admit, and you know, there would always, if it got heated, they would say, okay, let's wait till tomorrow and we'll talk about it again. So that's really when we spoke more about the work, is once he was finished with each piece, we would talk about it. And I will tell you this, that I did hear all the time about the paintings because my mother was the carpenter. My father was the artist, but my mom made all his frames, she mounted all his canvases, so they were a true team. They were a dream and a team, and she is his number one fan.
Yeah.
You know, without her, he could not have painted all of these beautiful paintings.
So let us kind of go back to Havana and meet him when he was a young man. And I'd like to turn over the conversation to Elizabeth now. Tell us a little bit about the Cuba that he came out of, and what he was born in 1920. What happened?
So first I'd just like to say how happy I am to be here and to share this with Hortensia and of course my husband, Roberto. We had the great fortune of meeting Maestro Soriano in Miami. Before he died, I think I came down there 2 or 3 times. And as Hortensia said, he was a wonderful man, very humble. And his wife, Milagros, your mother, was very responsible for this work, as well as Hortensia was saying, because she really believed in his vision. She really supported his vision, and they were a true love story, a true partnership. And she is the one who actually told me a lot about him as a young man. At 15 years old, he entered the Academy of San Alejandro, which is the esteemed art academy that all the greats went to in Cuba. And I think perhaps it might be helpful for us to understand that Cuba, even though it was an island, it was not isolated from the art dialogue. It wasn't marginalized. It was very much in the know, and it went back, this academy went back to the 19th century. So at the end of the 19th century, the beginning of the 20th century, most Cuban artists would go to Spain and to Italy to try to enhance their formation that they had started in Cuba. And so they were very much in dialogue and conversation with all these currents of information. So late 19th century, you can think of Romanticism, and you can think of symbolism, and you can kind of think of those, you know, plein air artists who were out doing these beautiful landscapes. And then what happened was very pivotal in 1927. There was a break from what we call academic painting, still lives, landscapes, and there was a new approach to painting, which was called vanguardia, which was avant-garde, modernism. And all these Cuban painters left Cuba and went to, of course, the epicenter of modernism, which was Paris. And they studied with the greats in Paris, and they entertained conversations in Paris, and came back to Cuba and began their own avant-garde movement, which was 1927 to about 1938. So those were mostly Parisian focused, so Cubism was very important at that point. The second generation was about 1938 to about 1950, and that generation, instead of looking to Paris, they looked to Mexico, and they looked to muralism, and they looked to the greats who were participating in Mexico, which were not only the muralist painters that we're so familiar with, such as Diego Rivera, Frida Kahlo, And I just was over at MOLA seeing that great exhibition there yesterday in Frida and Orozco and Siqueiros, but it was also a time of surrealism. So World War II had broken out in the 40s, so these artists that had been in Paris were no longer welcome. Where did they go? Some went to New York and others went to Mexico City. And they started a revival of the surrealist movement in Mexico City. So our friend, Rafael Soriano, was involved in the third generation, which is about 1950, mid-century modernism. You've heard of that back and forth. But he was schooled actually in the 40s by this second generation of professors who had been so instrumental in surrealism, in hybridity, in the Baroque, and also by the first generation modernist professors. So he had a wellspring, he had a wealth to nurture his art and from which he could draw when he finally decided to produce his own very special art. Now you have to remember that 1950s Cuba was unlike any other place because it was bookended really by two pivotal events. It was bookended in 1952 in the political arena by the coup of Batista, who came in, Fulgencio Batista, who came in and had been the president, had been elected president in the decade prior to the 50s. But in 1952, he decided he didn't want to wait for elections, so he would just, you know, have his own coup d'etat, and he came into power. So that was a very turbulent period politically in Cuban history. And then what happened in 1959 was Fidel Castro marches into Cuba January 1st of 1959, marches into Havana, and with that brings another whole wave, another revolution. So this decade of the 50s was very turbulent. And perhaps I was going to say despite, but maybe because of this turbulence, the aesthetic movements that were trying to respond to this social political activism really took a prominent place in Cuba history in the 1950s. So that's kind of a brief summary for your first question, and maybe there won't be any more, I don't know, that. But that kind of just sets the stage for what Soriano was involved in and what he was up against.
Great, thank you. Roberto, you were born in Havana.
Yes.
And I'm wondering if you could just bring us up to speed on this very momentous moment when Castro takes over and these artists leave. I mean, what, in terms of what you know as a, I would call you a theologian, philosopher, that is a profound, thinking of a German word that I can't translate right now, but a profound rupture, for lack of a better term, in a person's life, in a person's development. Tell us what that, first of all, what happened. I mean, most of us do know what happened, but what does that do to an artist?
Well, first of all, I too want to express my gratitude for being here. It's a real privilege to be a part of this amazing adventure, which it has been. It's hard to describe. I was only 6 years old, so my earliest memory is of sitting in an airplane, looking out the window, and waving goodbye to my father, who was staying behind. So it's hard to describe how profound that kind of an experience is. That one's first memory is a memory of leaving behind one's family, one's father, one's home. To this day, Elizabeth and I joke around, I get very anxious in airports, and I think it's somewhere deep in my psyche there's this sense that of the trauma of being in an airport. And for artists, certainly in Cuba, it would have been the same, and certainly for Soriano. Initially, Soriano left Cuba in 62, and initially his paintings were tolerated by the government. Eventually, like so many communist governments, maybe all communist governments, they wanted to control or dictate the kind of art that was produced, art that would go under the name of social realism, or that was more or less propaganda for the regime. So they denied the possibility of a kind of art that was free, and that didn't have a particular social aim. So in the face of that, Soriano was told he either had to abide by the dictates of the new communist government, or he had to leave, and he decided to leave in order to be able to continue his art. And Hortensia and Elizabeth can talk more about what happened afterwards, but that was certainly a traumatic experience for him. I think that's reflected very clearly in his art. Maybe we can talk about this later, but to me, when Elizabeth came to me, she was thinking about doing this exhibit, and she showed me an image of one of his paintings, and I was just blown away, like so many of you, I'm sure, when you see one of these for the first time. There are very few artists that I think I've responded to or reacted to in a similar way. So in my essay for the catalog, I tried to think about, okay, what is it about this art that is so powerful, that just is mesmerizing, really. And I think that ultimately it has to do with the fact that these paintings, this artwork, is really about inviting us, drawing us, really compelling us into communion. It is an artwork that draws us beyond ourselves, and even beyond the artwork itself, to that light that seems to come from behind or from within these beautiful paintings. So it's about drawing us into relationship with transcendence, with whatever you might want to call it, you know, some might call it God or the sacred, the holy. So it's a painting that is about relationship. And that's not surprising, given the fact that exile is about losing relationship. It's also why I think so many of these paintings evoke a kind of ambivalent response. Some people will look at some of these and say, "Well, that's scary," or it's kind of off-putting, some of the paintings. In fact, something can be both scary and fascinating and attractive at the same time. The German philosopher Rudolf Otto spoke about wrote a famous book called The Holy, or the Sacred. Holy. And he says the holy, however one might describe it, and different religions describe it differently, the holy is always both fascinating and terrifying. Those aspects of our lives where we feel we have lost control, we are in the presence of or in the grip of something beyond our ability to control. The most common experience perhaps is falling in love. When you fall in love, you're both fascinated and you're scared to death. Especially when you do it for the first time. You don't know what's happening. And so in those moments, we are drawn into connection, into a connectedness that draws us out of our isolation, out of our estrangement. But for that very reason, like any connection with another, being in love is another, again, a good example, we're not in control, and it is therefore scary. When we are in the presence of these incredible paintings, and we are drawn into that light that emanates from within, it's hard to get away. And at the same time, there's an ambivalence about it. I think that's one reason why they're so mesmerizing. To go back to the original point, that it's rooted in, I suspect, I'm just guessing, in the experience of exile, in this yearning for connection that comes out of the pain of estrangement and abandonment, and the ability to recognize in Soriano, I think, the power of not avoiding the estrangement, not avoiding the pain of that estrangement, but rooted in that pain to discover the possibility of a light that is emitted from within that pain, from within that yearning, from within that longing for communion. And so it's the relationship between exile and communion that I think and the refusal to resolve that tension that I think is reflected in the power of these paintings.
That's it. We can all go home. I was actually hoping we would get there by way of much later in our conversation, but since you were already there, but let us take a step back. Because one of the things that I think everybody who will visit this exhibition will notice is, like, when you walk in the door downstairs, you see one kind of art. Then as you go through the exhibition, this art changes. And then you come up here, and by the time you're here, you're exactly what you just described. Now, that's a trajectory that, of course, I totally agree with you, is fundamentally indebted to this idea of exile and alienation and so on and so forth. But I'd like us to trace a little bit how you got from A to B, or from A to Z, so to speak. And I think you can tell us a little bit about that, because I understand that when he first came to Florida, he didn't paint. He stopped painting, assuming that that was such a shock to the system that things just stopped.
Yes, absolutely. We came in 1962, and for 2 years, my father did not paint. He was, traumatized. He left his family, he left his friends, he left his beloved fine arts school of Matanzas that he helped found, and his beloved students that he had a wonderful relationship with. And so he kept thinking that we would go back, that this was temporary, and then we would go back. And as I said, for 2 years he stopped painting until one day he had an experience, and one might call it a dream, or it was an experience for him, and it was something that changed him. And he said to my mother, "This is our home now, this is where we put our roots." And after that experience is when he began painting again, and he was searching.
What was the experience?
He would come home after work, and he would take a nap. And this one particular day, he says, his story, that he was levitated from the bed, and this figure said to him, "Where do you want to go, Rafael?" And he said, "I want to see my little house in Matanzas." And he said he flew out on the feet of this figure, and he saw his house in Matanzas. And when he looked on the hill, he saw a bunch of wild horses, going down the hill, and it scared him. And he said, "And who are you?" And he said, "I am the Trinity." And with that, he, was laid down in bed, and he realized what was coming to his country, that they were not going back, and that the United States was his new home. And this is where he would make his life, and where we would make our life. And thanks to that experience, it was like a door opened for him, that he was able to step out of this, we're going back. We weren't going back. We unpacked the bags and we stayed. So
Elizabeth, I mean, that's a profound
experience
that is totally aligned with mysticism and goes back centuries when saints had, I'm thinking of the famous sculpture by Bernini, where people have dreams and all of a sudden a reality becomes apparent. How did that affect his art, Elizabeth?
So, and I'm thinking of Santa Teresa de Avila and Juan de la Cruz and Juan de la Cruz and some of these great mystics, and I think that's one of the reasons that in conversation with Roberto, we decided to put the title as Art as Mystic, Artist as Mystic. But to your point, Claudia, I would say, because one of the most frequently asked questions is, how did he paint like that down on the first floor and end up painting like this by the time he was in the 90s, 50 years later? So again, I go back to Cuba and I go back to the way he had learned to paint and all these aesthetic movements that were happening in the 50s. So the 50s in the United States, in Cuba, in Europe, in Latin America was all about abstraction. And when you look at the first floor and you see those beautiful geometric abstractions, you understand that this was the way in which the 50s, everybody was trying to express themselves. In Cuba in particular, there were two different visions, and that's why we have the sculptures in that one room which are displayed so beautifully. We see the sculptures by his colleague, Agustin Cárdenas, who is probably the foremost sculptor of the 20th century, Cuban sculptor of the 20th century. And Agustin Cárdenas pertained to a group called Los Once, the 11, and they had a particular vision of abstraction that was very inspired by nature. It was very organic, it was biomorphic, it was biological. And so those rounded shapes that you see down in that one gallery are juxtaposed against the second vision, which was a little bit later, and this was a vision of geometric abstraction with flat angular planes. And these were constructed in a cerebral way, not from nature, but from utopian visions of saying, we will determine what abstraction will be. We will decide what it is, and we will formulate that in our own plastic way, in our own way that we will create our vision, our utopian vision. And it will not be just Cuban, because those two previous generations were really interested, those avant-garde generations were interested in finding out how they could express Cubism, but in a very Cuban way, or surrealism, but in a very Cuban way. They were interested in the third generation of expression abstraction in a universal, utopian way. So the revolution that marched into Cuba on January 1st, to Havana, on January 1st of 1959, was precisely a utopian revolution that did embrace abstraction, that did embrace geometric abstraction. But as that revolution, as Roberto was mentioning, began to define its precepts and embrace communism by the 60s and 61, that's when the vision, the utopian vision, was impeded. It was it was fettered. It was not able to reach its logical conclusion. And those artists were told to paint in a certain way. And Rafael Soriano simply did not want to. And he did not want to the extent that he was able to leave his family, his profession, not only as a professor and director, but also he was at the height of his career in Cuba. He was being lauded and in the National Museum of Fine Arts, and he was being exhibited all over Latin America. He left and went to Miami, and frankly, he became a nobody. Yeah. Nobody knew him. Mm-hmm. Nobody cared. And in fact, he still believed in abstraction. But in the United States, abstract expressionism was waning, and pop art was coming up. Now, if you look around you, pop art and Rafael Soriano's vision, they are disparate, you know, they're very far, very, very far from each other. So what was he to do? He, as has been expressed by my colleagues, he was traumatized. He wrote about being traumatized. And he wrote that it was no longer enough to paint geometric abstractions. It no longer satisfied his emotional, spiritual need. So these abstractions began to morph, these geometrics became very malleable and began to incorporate this more organic, biological, biomorphic interpretation of abstraction that had first nurtured his work. And you can see and follow this kind of morphing throughout the decades, where he is now beginning to consider all types of biomorphic, organic representation, and link that kind of with surrealism. So you see eventually, after decade and decades of work, that tension within him between geometrics and abstraction and surrealism was fused together in this very singular approach to his work. I mean, if I look at this beautiful painting here that you are so fortunate to own at the museum, Añoranza Idealizada, that he painted in 1991, if you look at that, you can see vestiges of the geometrics, only those geometrics have now rounded and become really a view of geometrics from the inside, as opposed to looking at them from the outside.
I mean, it's interesting that you say that, because we were, the docents and I were downstairs in the galleries, and one of the things that we tried to do is actually tease out some of the elements that are present in the geometric abstractions. And you realize, when you really start looking, that there's a lot of stuff is already there. It's already, the fact that it's, yes, it's geometric abstraction, but it's layered. There's a diaphanous kind of quality to the paintings, where sometimes there's a triangle and then there is a round shape right behind it. So then we discovered at some point where all of a sudden it's not just an all over painting with things that look like tiles, but there's all of a sudden there's a light source coming from behind. So it's something, and I really appreciated your idea of this utopian quality that was there in the 50s, which then is in a way kind of the seedbed for something that Roberto was talking about, that you can't, I guess what I'm saying is, you can't end up here out of nowhere.
Right.
You have to, there has to be stuff already embedded in something that may at first glance look very, very different, but then eventually you and so the more I look at it, the more I understand the interconnectedness of all these paintings. And I want to ask Roberto, I mean, this idea of exile and immigration, I mean, being German is very interesting to me, because, you know, and living in Los Angeles, where we have a lot of people that came from probably more hostile and persecuted circumstances, but it is a profoundly rupturing event in a human life. But it's, would you say that Soriano's paintings are, they seem to me, at least in the truest of the word, sublime, right? Sublime being an aesthetic category that was developed in the early, 19th century.
Yeah.
Along with the picturesque and the beautiful. The sublime is that which is both awe-inspiring and beautiful. It overwhelms you with pleasure and fear.
Yes.
And it's that being on the threshold to that which is beyond that, I think, is, and it's borne out in his biography, is crossing over into something, and then ultimately what death is all about, and birth, and so it's very universal. Yeah.
Well, that's precisely the distinction that I was trying to get at. In fact, you took the words right out of my mouth, because I was going to bring that up later. The distinction between the sublime and the beautiful, which is a traditional kind of philosophical distinction. There's a difference between a beautiful painting or a pretty painting and this.
Right.
And I think that's precisely the difference, is the sublime. What I was trying to get at, that these paintings draw us not so much to themselves as beyond and through themselves to something else, something greater, something transcendent. The word transcendent is up there somewhere, but the transcendent is not discovered, you know, out in heaven somewhere. The transcendent is discovered in our midst when we live life fully in its deepest sense. And I think that's what comes across here, is the discovering of the sublime within the imminent.
I also, you know, I rarely have the opportunity to talk to a theologian, so you have to forgive me, because I'm, one of the things I'm reminded of, and you can blow me out of the water right away, because I'm not a philosopher, but is I'm looking at these things, and I'm reminded of stained glass windows. And the reason I'm reminded of them, I mean, aside from the colors and all that stuff, but this idea of the luminous. And I, you know, this idea of Neoplatonic is the word, where light itself becomes the messenger, right? So you have that, and of course I understand your point in your essay in the book, which I highly recommend, you know, not a plug, don't leave home without it, or leave the museum without it, is that you, have kind of a dialogue with the divine, right? And divine can be whatever, you know. I mean, you know, you can be an atheist and still relate to that which is other than you and which is greater than you. And light, I mean, think about Abbot Suji, you know, the light as a reflection of the divine. And I think he was kind of going there, you know, and really kind of expressing, you know, something that he felt very deeply.
Yes.
Yes. I don't know, you probably have.
No, absolutely. I think he painted at night, and I do believe that he was, when he painted, he was in deep meditation and in touch with the divine. And you see it.
I think also, something that you said, Claudia, is very important, and that you said he's universal. And I think what Soriano paints is the human experience. He doesn't just paint the beautiful, he doesn't just paint suffering, but people have come up to me and they said, you know, was he a happy man? And I said, yes, he was very happy. Well, he looks tortured. You can be tortured, you can suffer, but you can still be happy. And vice versa. So they're not either or, it's not exclusionary. And I think in this world that we all share, this human experience, you rarely come across somebody who can touch your soul. And I think he touches people's souls without explanation, without us up here, without any background. I think you can come to Master Soriano's work and you can look at that and you can say, I understand. Because everybody has an experience and everybody has the full experience of life and the human experience. And I think that is what he is able to capture, which is very difficult to do. So he's hard to describe.
No, but I like this concept that you and Roberto has touched on it, this idea of separation, which is of course not just in terms of exile. It's like at the moment a baby leaves the mother's womb, you're separated, you're alone, you know. And was it Erich Fromm who said that the struggle of the human is to find connection with each other, with God, with whatever, is to overcome that sense of separation and aloneness. And I think that's what I will be perfectly honest, when I first saw these paintings, I was like, oh my God, creepy. You know, it's exactly that terrifying. There is a terrifying element in these paintings because you hate to be lost in them. I do, which maybe that tells you more about how scared I am. But it is. It's you're coming face to face with an abyss, if you will, for lack of a better word, and that can be both hopeful and profoundly terrifying. Help me.
I agree. No, I agree. And I think, I mean, precisely the reason why we experience isolation and estrangement as painful is because we are not built for that. We're built for something else. And that's what these paintings are trying to remind us and draw us into, is to that connection, that relatedness. After all, the word religion comes from religio, which means to bind together. Religion is about binding, is about connecting what has been disconnected, what has been estranged. And that's a very powerful message and experience in a society that glorifies individualism and isolation. and then we glorify individualism and the self-made man and woman, quote unquote, and then we complain because we're lonely or we're depressed. Well, it's the kind of the logical outcome of that. And I think these paintings challenge us to let go of that and to allow ourselves to be connected, to go out of the self and to allow ourselves to be drawn into some reality beyond ourselves.
I'd like to open it up for people in the audience. We've been gassing on long enough. I'm sure people have questions. Is there anybody here who would venture? Yes.
In the catalog, there's mention of the artist being a concrete painter. I've never come upon that expression before. What is concrete?
So concrete is just another word for geometric. So it's an academic term. So he was a geometric painter or a concrete painter. It was taking from that idea, that kind of intellectual precept that we will make concrete what we want of this abstraction. We will choose forms that we manipulate, not forms that come from nature, but forms that we can decide upon. And so that's where it comes. It's just a simple.
Does it also entail a sense of the tangible?
In what sense?
Well, when something is very concrete, it's very tangible. I think there's a different meaning to that.
Possibly. But I mean, I think when you think of utopian views, you think of not necessarily concrete. I think you think of what could be, not what is. And so, you know, to a certain extent, it could. But I think the most important thing to think of is just that these geometrics were positioned together maybe in concrete ways or whatever, but they were a way that was manipulated and it wasn't left to chance. It was manipulated, had a purpose, was very cerebral, and this was to link in with this utopian idea of the fearsome and marvelous achievements of the space age and how Latin America was going to reinterpret that through their own lens and make something of that for themselves.
Mentioned that in his exile he always painted at night. Did he ever start painting like an artist during the day and not having a job, a day job?
No, he painted at night because he had a day job and he was the art director for Popular Mechanics for many, many years. He painted at night also, even when he was not working and he was just painting full time. He said that at night is when the creativity came to him. So during the day he was helping my mom, cutting the wood and stuff like that, and at night is when he painted.
But do you know if in Cuba he actually painted during the day?
You know, that's a great question. I don't know. I'll have to ask my mom because I had not been born yet, so I'll get back to you on that.
I do know in Cuba that he was the director and professor, which took up a lot of his time. So I would be surprised to find out that he was actually able to paint during the day with those two very demanding positions. But it could be that he found a little bit of time in there to paint during the day, but he is quoted as saying that he was a nighttime painter. He liked to paint at night.
I would like to ask or touch upon one area that we haven't touched upon yet. We talked about religion and so forth. How about politics? I mean, here's a man who left because of political circumstances, and I understand that he was not a very political person. And we kind of bounced around this term of inner immigration, and I don't know how familiar people are with this idea, but for example, in Germany,
when a lot of what was modernism at the time was decried as degenerate art. You know, artists either left, or if they didn't leave, they stayed, but painted differently. They abandoned their political, you know, people like Otto Dix, I mean, you name it, they or Max Beckmann, they painted differently. They went into what is called internal exile. So they painted beautiful landscapes. They stopped being political. Now, he was probably never given the abstract nature of his work, but he was, on some level, political because he made a stand with his art in Cuba. I mean, here we're utopia, to being a utopianist, you have to be political on some level. So my question is, how do you navigate that, the political aspect, and then coming to Florida into a community, into a Cuban exile community, which was probably very conservative and hostile to what things, you know, I was wondering how he navigated that.
So I would say that the 50s in Cuba was a hotbed of political activity, and so there's no way to escape it. And as I kind of mentioned, everybody embraced the revolution at the beginning, thinking, oh, we're getting rid of that very corrupt dictator, Fulgencio Batista. And Fidel Castro was looked on as El Salvador, the savior. You know, he came down, he was 33 years old, the dove rested on his shoulder, and so he had all these kind of symbolic references going on. In the end, I don't think that Rafael Soriano was political at all. I think he came to Miami because there was a culture, extended family, and a language that he could identify with. And he didn't get mixed up in exile politics when he was there. He just painted. I do think it's interesting, Claudia, to note that when we spoke to him about having this exhibition leave Long Beach Museum of Art, go to Miami, and then eventually go to Havana, we were very concerned about what his opinion might be. We would never take this exhibit to Havana if he did not want to, and certainly there's a lot of visceral, very strong emotion about Cuba in the Miami community. But he basically wanted it to go back to Cuba. He wanted his paintings to be once again shown at the National Museum of Fine Arts, and not for any political statement, but because he wanted to reach out to the people. He wanted to reach out to the pueblo. He wanted to have his students, who might still be alive, his family, his community, his country, his people, to know how the movie ended. How did he end up painting? They haven't seen this. In fact, when we were in Matanzas with Hortensia and Lisa Fakeman, who's doing all the video reproductions here, we showed his book to some of his former students, and one of them began to sob. She began to cry, and she said, "This is what he was trying to tell me. This is the way he wanted to paint. He always told me at the height of his abstraction that he wasn't satisfied, that there was something else within him that he had to tap into. This is it." So I think he was apolitical to the end, but I think he was human to the end.
It just adds, I mean, I'm very much looking forward to this work going to Havana, because I think in a way that would make the communion complete. I'm wondering what, if you see it.
I agree, that's a, you know, it's a very good point. I think it would be a coming home, certainly, for Rafael Soriano, in a very profound and very moving way. Or Deza can maybe speak more intimately to this.
Well, when all of this happened, and he was still alive, and I said to him one day, I said, you know, Bobby, would you like your work to be seen in Cuba again, in Museo Nacional de Bellas Artes in Havana? And he looked at me with such love in his face, and he said, of course, like, it's a no-brainer. Of course I'd love people to see my work that I created here and in this beautiful country of ours and freedom, because for him, what was important was freedom, was to be free. And I remember as a child, I asked him, you know, why did we leave Cuba? And I distinctly remember him saying, because they told me that I had to paint doves. And he said, I am painting what I want to paint. And I think that was his moment when he said, I got to get out of here. And he wanted to be free. And that was one of the reasons he also, and his friends, established the School of Fine Arts in Matanzas, because he wanted his students to have the freedom to express themselves, not so much with the rigidity and the academic rigor that was the San Alejandro Academy. So for him, freedom was
everything.
Yes.
Thank you for the question.
More pastels that other people have collected throughout the years. And you know, it's funny because the pastels have such a three-dimensional quality also as his oils, and he loved doing them. But the honest truth is my mother made him do it because we could sell them easier. So you
economically.
Yeah, at that time she would say to him, okay, let's do a pastel or two. So you know, because we had to, you know, eat it.
Sorry,
how,
I think there was
how much would
he
get for a pastel?
What I wanted to say in great emotion, the three of you captured in reference to whether El Maestro Soriano wanted his work to return to Cuba. When I was researching and reading before I got the catalog, I wept when I read the news release. That the work was going to end in Miami. However, now it was traveling to Havana, and I had to sit down and weep because he was going home just as he had levitated and spiritually experienced that return and knew that he had to move his family here in the United States. But now,
thank you.
Yes, sir.
Well, I have found your discussion fascinating from the historical, political, theological standpoint. But I still feel that we are leaving one important aspect out, which is color. Because one of the fascinating things about this particular painter is the use of color. And not so much light as of the search for light. There is light in the paintings, but at the same time, it seems to be something that each canvas is struggling towards, rather than something that is there. Mm-hmm. So that's one comment I wanted to make, but I also wanted to ask a question. We know that Maestro Soriano wanted to be shown in Cuba. But what about the Cuban government? Does it want Soriano back?
Well, that's a great question. And I actually have gone three times to talk to three different directors, and the Minister of Culture, and the Minister of Foreign Affairs. And so it's not easy, but they have accepted, and they would like to have us. And so it is scheduled on their docket for March of 2018. And so we're very happy about that. Yes, and I appreciate your comment on the color. And we are limited here today, but it is all in the catalog, where we do talk quite a lot of it about his color.
But can I just add about the color? Because it really blows me away sitting here and being able to see the ocean and how connected my father was to the ocean, because his colors have to do with his, you know, Bay of Matanzas, which changed colors six or seven times. Mm-hmm. And they loved the Bay of Matanzas, and these colors, he always said, had to do with those changing colors. So just a brief thing on the colors.
And I want to add a comment about the color. I mean, that one of the things that I appreciated those, and what's kind of also the creepy part of these later paintings, is their kind of watery quality. So it's kind of almost like amniotic fluid that you're kind of swimming in. You see kind of particles floating around, and so it's that kind of ground of that that we can connect to. You know, that is both, it works in both directions. It works upward toward transcendence, but it also works downward into the ground and into the ground of our existence, you know. And color, of course, don't forget, light is color, right? So whenever you see color, you're seeing light, you know. But what you do with that light is can be very different, but yes, it's an important observation.
It's also important to observe that he was a master colorist and a master painter. He's been described as a painter's painter, much like Rembrandt or Velázquez. You see this, you know, this Baroque, that chiaroscuro.
All of which were important colorists.
Exactly, and you can't become this. It's after decades of working at it. But he is recognized as being a master painter because you can't just imitate that.
Yeah, I think at the same time, the color is not an end in itself. They're not meant to be pretty pictures that are just, but to convey, I think, the sublime, and this is where your point about the struggle is, I think, right on target. That is, these are paintings about yearning, about longing, about seeking, and hopefully, as you were saying, that seeking will be resolved someday in Havana. And it's a seeking for communion, for home. And
it's a becoming.
It's the becoming, and that always involves struggle. It always involves pain.
Yes,
Randy.
Just as the art
of
the painting
Mona
Lisa in Cuba has changed directors, we have a different director in our country. Is this exhibition safe and ongoing, and is not going to be victim to political changes here?
Well, I think, as you might have realized by this morning's tweet, none of us are safe. But I would say, nothing in life is guaranteed, and so we don't know what's going to happen. And we're forging ahead, and I think we're waiting for the stars to align, and so far they're aligned, and maybe. Our esteemed leader will stop tweeting and wake up and say, wait, Soriano's going to Cuba, I better stop that. But I think we might be a little safe on that.
By the way, if and when, and hopefully when he returns to the National Museum in Havana, he would be representing not only himself of returning home, but to a certain extent all of us Cuban Americans, Cuban exiles, returning home, because he would be the first ever, I believe, Cuban exile painter to be exhibited in the museum in Havana.
Retrospective. That's true. And we did talk with Ambassador Jeff De Laurentiis, and he is our new embassy, and he is very excited about supporting this because he says it represents, you know, the perfect exhibition of a person who has lived half of his life in the United States, half of his life in Cuba, and represents that idea of reconciliation and of being together and of being one people with differences. But nonetheless, it would be perhaps through art a way in which we can heal that politics cannot quite reach for yet.
You had a question.
I was wondering how you came to Master Soriano, how you found him.
Yes, how did I find the great love of my life? I was in my second grade. So truly. I have a weakness for Cubans, in case you can't tell. So I was actually working on another artist from the second generation by the name of Wilfredo Lam, who was a great artist and was born in Cuba, and I was down in Cuba researching and in the National Museum of Fine Arts and their archives and talking to some of these specialists there on his work and looking at his paintings, which have never been allowed out, the ones that are in the National Museum of Fine Arts. And my colleague there, Roberto Covas Amate, with whom I have collaborated now on two exhibitions, he said, you know, I don't think you have properly seen our Rafael Sorianos. And he began to talk to me about him, and I knew of him in, as an abstract artist, a concrete artist, but I was not familiar with his later works, and he started to show me, because there was a wonderful retrospective at the Loewe Museum in Miami, Miami University, and he had a brochure, and I saw some of these paintings, and I was very intrigued, as Claudia was saying, is how he got from point A to point Z. And I do like to do painters who are very universal, and seem to have a lot of heft and meat on their bones. And I was instantly fascinated by Soriano and decided to embark on that journey. And of course, I met Hortensia and Maestro Soriano and Milagros, which I have said, Milagros means miracles in Spanish, and Hortensia means flower. So between one very special flower and a couple of miracles, we've been able to pull this off.
Are there any of his early works still in Cuba?
Yes, the Museum of Museo Nacional de Bellas Artes has five of his paintings, the collection of the 1950s.
But they're of the abstract era.
All geometrics. Yeah. The people of Cuba have never seen this.
And we're fortunate to have two 40s pieces here. These are the only 40s pieces we know that exist today. We have albums that show how he was painting in the 40s and how he was drawing. So as scholars, we're able to reach into that information and make a lot of great conclusions. But none of the 40s paintings are available. They're gone. And only the ones in the National Museum of Fine Arts, and we're able to identify about a handful of others in private collections and in the Museum of Matanzas. So that's all there are.
I was just gonna ask, Orty, can you talk about your favorite painting and what is behind that painting?
She's talking about the Angustia del Olvido, which is right here next to my father's picture. And
as you walk up the stairs.
As you walk up the stairs, and it's the howl, it's this, you see the anguish in that painting. It is because in 1996 he was diagnosed with dementia. And I think he never talked about it, but certainly we see how he felt about it, the anguish and the anxiety and the fear of what he was experiencing. So for me, that's always, you know, been a favorite painting of mine. So,
Angustia del Olvido means anguish of forgetting.
You brought a poem.
Oh, it's really not a poem. It's it's just a words that my father would say a lot. It's a quote, and he says, "I do not pretend to transmit a message of reality. I am moved by the longing to travel through my paintings in a dimension of spirit where the intimate and the cosmic converge."
I think that's a beautiful note to end on.
We really do have a dream, and Milagros, the miracle, and with these three amazing people, and including myself, not being amazing, but one to the staff, we have to get this to Havana, and it has to be there. So you know, everyone in this room may be called on to help to do that. Because I think that right now the State Department isn't able to give any kinds of answers for anything. And that could work for us or against us. But we really want that to happen, and we're going to be able to make that happen. So I thank you all for being part of today. I thank you.